Good morning all. Today we are going to discuss about active, reactive and the apparent power and what is the power factor and what is its significance. Before proceeding to that, let us see that practically if you take any circuit, the circuit will be inductive loads only. Then the inductive load will be the combination of the inductor in series with a resistor. Or we can tell that if I am taking my voltage as my reference, the current passing because of the inductive load will lag behind this voltage by some angle phi. So this angle is phi. So out of this component, the current can be resolved into two components. One is out of phase component and other one is in phase component. The in phase component will become equal to I cos phi and out of phase component will be equal to I sin phi. So now what I am doing, I am multiplying this current with a voltage V. So if I multiply, this will become VI cos phi and this current becomes V into I and this component becomes VI sin phi. So I am just summarizing here. This is my voltage. This component become VI cos phi. This component, so I am just taking the parallel to this. This becomes VI sin phi and this component becomes V into I. This is my angle phi. So this V into I, this is called as the apparent power. And this V into sin phi is called as the reactive power. And this is the active power. We know that active power in any circuit we have just derived in the case of RL circuit. We have seen the active power will be equal to V into I into cos phi. Or this active power I can write as V into I into cos phi. This I cos phi, V multiplied by I cos phi. That this is the current in phase with the voltage. This is responsible for the active power loss. And S is V into I. That is the power which is actually supplied from your source. Because if you are seeing from the source point of view, source is supplying a voltage V and a current I. So the source assumes it is supplying a power of V multiplied by I. So that's why it is called as apparent power, which is assumed to be transmitted. To complete this triangle, one more extra component is coming. That component we call it as the reactive power Q. So let us see each one of this in detail now. First one, I am starting with the apparent power. Apparent power, the total power that appears to be transferred between the source and the load is called apparent power. So what does it mean? So whenever you connect any circuit, let us assume I am connecting my supply, I have connected to my RL load or any load. So we don't know what is inside. So whenever you apply the voltage, it takes some current. So if you will measure, the voltage using voltmeter, current using ammeter, and if I ask you to calculate the power, you will tell as the product of V into I. Because this is what I can measure using voltmeter ammeter. So this is what your source will assume. I am supplying the current I. I have my voltage V. That means I am supplying my power V into I. So this is actually is assumed to be supplied. So that's why it is called as apparent. It is only apparent value. So the same thing I have defined here. The total power that appears to be transferred between source and load. This is called as the apparent power. But this is not the actual power, because we know the inductor will take the power for one quarter of the cycle and return the power for the another quarter of the cycle. We have seen when we are discussing about the pure L load that one quarter cycle it is taking the power, another quarter cycle it is returning back the power. So the net power will be equal to zero. So apparent power is not the actual power. Now coming to the second type of power called as the true power. True power, or it is also called as active power. So let us see what is the definition and then we will go for the analysis. The power which is actually consumed in the circuit. The power which is actually consumed in the circuit is called as true power or active power. This is called as true power or active power. So what is true power? The true power is the current in phase with the voltage produces the true power. That means if you take the current, so let us take for example, this is my voltage we have taken, this is my current, the current is lagging by some angle phi, the current should be in phase with the current. That means in phase component we can tell it is because of the resistor. That means in the resistance always the current and voltage will be in phase with each other. Voltage across the resistor and current through the resistor will be in phase with each other. So this is called as in phase component, this is called as in phase component of the current or active component of my current. So this component will be responsible for the active power loss in a circuit. So we have seen in the last class the true power derivation, the true power is equal to P is equal to V into I into cos phi. So this I can multiply as V into I cos phi, the component of current in the direction of voltage. So this I can write as V is nothing but I into Z, because current multiplied by impedance is my voltage. This I can write as I, and cos phi. Cos phi I can use my impedance triangle. Using the impedance triangle, we know that if this is R, this is my value of XL and this is my value of Z. So I can write this cos phi is equal to R by Z. So this resultant will be equal to I square into R, because Z Z will cancel. This will become I square into R. That means we can conclude that whatever power loss is there, that happens only because of the resistance. The inductor never contribute for any component of the power loss. So this I cos phi is called as in phase component or watt full component. This is the component which is responsible for production of some power. So let us see the third type of power. The third type of power we call as reactive power. Third type of power is called as reactive power. Again, I am drawing the power triangle here. So this is my active power. This is VI cos phi. This is nothing but V into I. This is apparent power. So to complete the triangle, we need one more side. This side is nothing but V into I into sin phi. V into I into sin phi. So this is called as the reactive power. So let us see the definition first, then try to analyze this. So the component of apparent power which is neither consumed nor does any useful work, nor does any useful work in the circuit is called reactive power. So this is called as the reactive power, or we can tell that the power consumed in the inductor, or even you can take the capacitor, the power consumed in the inductor or capacitor are called as the reactive power. The power consumed in the are called the reactive power, because if you calculate the power, we have seen in the case of pure inductive load, what is the power consumed in the inductor? We got the power consumed in the inductor is equal to zero. Zero. Why it is zero? Because all the power received from the source in one quarter cycle is returned to source in next quarter cycle. So some of you may be seeing this lecture for the first time, so I am trying to derive it. So I am just representing the graphical representation. This is V. I am taking as V maximum sin omega t. We know in the inductor the current lags the voltage by 90 degrees. So current is lagging this voltage by 90 degrees. So the current waveform will be like this. This is my current waveform. Current I is equal to I maximum sin omega t minus 90 degrees. This is for the case of inductor. So if you want to calculate the power, so power will be the product of voltage and current at every point. So you multiply at this point, it will be 0. This point also 0. This point and this point will be 0. So in between, when you are multiplying the product of two things, if one sign is negative, the power will be negative. If both ends are positive or negative, in that case it will be positive. So here it will be negative. So your power will come like this. So here both are positive, so your power is like this. Again here you can see it will be negative and it will be positive. So I am just trying to represent this. This is my power. So you can see here, this is my half cycle, right? Half cycle of your supply. So out of this half cycle, in one quarter cycle the power is taken and another quarter cycle the power is returned back. That means the average power is becoming equal to zero. That means inductor doesn't take any active part. So it will take the power, return the power, take the power, return the power. If you want to represent what is the power taken by this inductor, so that I can represent by using the reactive power. So that is the third part of the triangle, which is given by Q is equal to V into I into sin phi. The units of V into I into sin phi are VI is nothing but the volt ampere, and sin phi. Sin phi we represent by the reactive, because it is volt amperes that is taken from the supply which are reactive. Actually, this is also the apparent thing. We are just assuming, practically it is not there. So this I sin phi I can call as the reactive component or wattless component, because it doesn't contribute for any power loss in your circuit, because power is taken and going back. So again I am repeating, so we have seen the active power P is the power that is actually doing the work, which is given by V into I into cos phi, or this is nothing but I square into R, the power loss in the resistor. This is because of the active component of the current I cos phi, or the current in phase with the voltage. So the units of this are watts. Then we have seen the apparent power. Apparent power is the power that is actually assumed to be transmitted from the source point of view. So the units will be equal to voltage multiplied by current. This is volt amperes. Then the third power we have seen, the called as a reactive power. It is the current that is passing, or the power that is taken by the inductor. Actually it is assumed to be taken. Practically inductor doesn't consume the power, because in one quarter cycle it takes the power, another quarter cycle it returns back the power. So this I have multiplied with V into I into sin phi. This units are volt, amperes, reactive. So this is represented simply by VAR or KVAR, kilovolt ampere reactive. R stands for reactive here. So let us now see what is power factor. What is power factor? So we have seen in the pure resistive load, if you want to calculate the power, power P will be simply equal to V into I. We have derived in the case of pure resistive load. But when you are taking the RL load or RC load, so in this case the power P will be equal to V into I into cos phi. Why this phi is happening? So this phi is happening because of, this is my VR, this is my value of VL, this is my resultant voltage, so this is my reference value of the current, this angle is phi. So this is happening because of the component of reactive voltage or the reactive component. So because of that, your power, that V into I, should be multiplied by some factor cos phi to get your actual power. It is a factor by which the product of V into I or the apparent power should be multiplied to get your actual power is called as power factor of the circuit. I am repeating again, the factor by which your apparent power or the power that is assumed to be transferred is multiplied to get the actual value of the power consumed is called as power factor of the circuit. How can I get the power factor? I can get using the impedance triangle. The impedance triangle will be, this is my value of R, this is my value of XL, and this is my value of Z. This is the case of inductive reactance. This angle will be equal to phi if it is the RL load. If it is RC load, there will be a resistance. The inductance, the capacitive reactance will be lagging the resistance by some angle, 90 degrees. So this is my value of Z. Here also it will be phi. If both L and C are existing, I have to take the resultant of XL and XC. That means if I want to calculate cos phi from this triangle, cos phi is nothing but R by Z. So this I can write as R by Z is square root of R square plus XL minus XC whole square. Because we don't know how much value of XL is there and XC. Because you can see here, XL and XC are exactly 180 degrees opposite to each other. So in a circuit, if both are there, so you have to take the resultant of this them. So resultant will be XL minus XC, or you can take XC minus XL. Practically all the loads are inductive loads. That's why we always take the XL minus XC, because it always gives the positive value. So this is the way you have to calculate the power factor. So I hope these concepts are clear to you. Let us proceed with some examples. So I am taking one example. A current I is equal to 14.14 sine of omega t minus pi by 6 flows in an electric circuit when a voltage of V is equal to 141.4 sine omega t is applied to it. Determine the power factor of the circuit determine also the values of true power, apparent power and the reactive power of the circuit. So let us try to note down what is given. It is given that there is one circuit, the current is equal to 14.14 sine omega t minus pi by 6 and voltage is 141.4 sine omega t. I am just noting down the same values here, 141.4 sine omega t, and the value of I is 14.14 sine of omega t minus pi by 6. So from this I can tell that if voltage is my reference, the current is lagging it by some angle of pi by 6 or 30 degrees. This is my current I. So we know the value of phi. So from this I can calculate my value of cos phi. So cos phi will be equal to cos 30 degrees. We get as 0.866, because it is inductive, current is lagging, it becomes a lag, LAG. So then the voltage, RMS value of voltage will be equal to maximum value by root 2. So this is 141.4 divided by root 2. So this will become 100 volts. Similarly, RMS value of the current will be equal to I maximum by root 2. This will be 14.14 divided by root 2. This becomes equal to 10 amperes. So if you want to calculate the true power is equal to V into I into cos phi. We know the value of V, we know the value of I and the cos phi. So V is 100, I is 10, cos phi is 0.866. This becomes 866 watts. So similarly, I can calculate my apparent power is nothing but V into I, which is assumed to be transmitted. So this will be equal to 1000. What are the units? Volt amperes. So if you want to calculate the reactive power is given by Q. Q is equal to V into I into sin phi. So this will become 100 into 10 into sin 30 degrees. So remember here, whenever you are substituting in sine of the angle, if angle is in degrees, you have to take in degrees mode. If the angle is in radians, you have to keep it, your calculator in the radians mode and calculate. Otherwise, you will not get the answer. So this will become 500. What are the units? Volt ampere reactive, or this is nothing but VAR. So now it is also asked to calculate, any other things are asked, only it is asked to calculate true power, apparent power and reactive power of the circuit. So we have calculated them. So let us assume I want to calculate the other parameters also. How can I calculate? If I can want to calculate the value of Z, Z is nothing but equal to V by I. V by I is 100 by 10 is equal to 10 ohms. So I can calculate the value of R and X from the impedance triangle. This is my value of phi. This is XL. This is R and Z. So R is equal to Z cos phi. So from this I can calculate 8.66 ohms. And if you want to calculate XL, XL will be equal to Z sin phi. So if you substitute, you will get this value as 5 ohms. So this way I can calculate from the impedance triangle. So I am taking another example to further clarify this. An alternator is supplying a load of 300 kilowatt at a power factor of 0.6 lag if the power factor is raised to unity, how many more kilowatt of power can the alternator supply for the same KVA rating? This is asked. So, whenever you design any machine, any electrical machine, the rating of the machine depends on two things. One is how much heat it can withstand and what is the value of current or what are the losses in the machine. So, and third one is the insulation. So, what is the insulation required for protecting it? So, the insulation depends on the voltage and the losses or the heat that depends on the value of the current that is passing through the circuit. So, that's why your rating of any machine is always given in KVA or volt amperes. It is never given in kilowatt. The reason is this one only. Because the rating of the machine only depends on two things. One is the heating and the second one is the insulation or insulation strength of the materials. So, that is the reason. So, for the given KVA rating, the machine can supply more load, more kilowatt or the active power to the circuit if your power factor is more. So, this numerical is something related to this. So, you will understand what is the significance of power factor using this numerical. So, it is given there, initially the power P1 is equal to 300 kilowatts when the power factor cos phi 1 is equal to 0.6 lagging. So, now it is telling that cos phi 2 is now increased to unity. So, what will be the value of the active power it can supply? So, let us first calculate what is the KVA rating of your circuit. KVA rating is equal to, we know the active power is equal to V into I into cos phi, or it is nothing but S cos phi, because P I can write as V into I into cos phi. So, this is the KVA rating. So, I can get my VI is equal to P divided by cos phi. So, I can just divide 300 divided by 0.6. This is my KVA rating. So, KVA rating is equal to 500 KVA. KVA rating is not going to change. So, now the power factor is changed cos phi 2. So, the active power 2 will be equal to this KVA multiplied by the new power factor. New power factor is 1. So, what is the new power that can be supplied? It can supply now 500 kilowatt. You can see for the same rating, the power supplied is increased now. What is the change in the power? The additional power is equal to, the new power is 500 kilowatt, but initially it is supplying only 300 kilowatt because of the load. That means it can supply 200 kilowatt extra. That's why always in your electrical circuits, we want your power factor should be maintained near to the unity. So, this is not the only reason. This is one more reason also. The losses, the I square R losses depends on the current. So, if the power factor is less for a given power, because we know the power P is equal to V into I into cos phi, let us assume your load is constant. Okay, if the power factor is decreased, so to get the same load, because voltage is fixed, once the circuit is designed, your voltage is fixed, because voltage depends on the insulation. If your power factor is less, to compensate for this, automatically current drawn will be more. When current drawn will be more, the I square R losses are increasing, or every conductor is overloaded, or we can tell the rating of the machine will fall down. So, in order to avoid this, what should I do? I have to maintain this value as far as possible near to the unity. So, in that way, I can save my energy. So, I hope this is clear to you. If you still have any queries, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. I will answer to your queries from there. Thank you. Thank you very much.